Good morning.
Good morning.
What an absolutely beautiful day to be in the house of the Lord. Another beautiful day. It's supposed to be like in the 60s again today, and I love that. But no, welcome to Peace Lutheran Church. Well, you know, we should close and make you all move up 5 pews, because you're a long ways away today. But anyway, people are like, please don't. But anyway, Roger, way back there, but welcome, and my name is Pastor Luke. If you don't know who I am, but thank you for coming. We are going to have a service today, which is going to be kind of a neat service because we get the choir that's going to sing again. And so we'll be doing that in just a second. But I do want to show you a couple things that are on the announcements. Tomorrow, happy Valentine's Day, by the way, early, and anniversary. Tomorrow there's going to be a movie fellowship starting here at 2 o'clock. It'll be in the fellowship hall. It's the story of William Carey, and so please come to that if you can. We might be making it some changes, but we're trying out Monday and seeing how that works. And so please come to that. Other things that are coming up Tuesday, that's not on the bulletin. Tuesday we have council meeting at 7 o'clock. And then Wednesday, Peace Corps and Junior Choir practice at 3:45. Since last week, a lot of the confirmation kids could not make it. We're having it this Wednesday instead. So Wednesday, confirmation, 4 o'clock. Switches at 6:30. Worship Choir practice, it's still at 7 on Wednesday night. And then we have a little special thing coming up on Saturday. You're all invited to come to Merlin Yonke's 90th birthday. And he got a brand new haircut, just getting ready for that time. But it's a come by, stop in. Yes, sir. Hi. Right then, sure. He's going to be sore. But anyway, so yeah, please come to his birthday party. It starts at 2 o'clock, and it's going to last, I think, till 4. But please come on by and be part of that. And then, of course, next week you see that stuff coming up is our normal service next week. And then our annual meeting is on the 27th. Please plan on staying for that. Okay, well, is there any other things that I missed? You don't think so? Well, why don't we pray then? Father God, thank you. Thank you for being who you are, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And Lord, as we are in your house today, Lord, I'm just asking that you would open our ears and eyes and hearts to the truth that's in your word. And Lord, I thank you for the last few hours that we've had together as we were studying the book of Acts and the kids were in Sunday school. Lord, it was fun to be here this morning. And allow us to continue to focus on what we're here for. I know today is a big day and a lot of people are focused on a football game, but today let us focus on you and focus on what you want to teach us. We love you, we thank you, and we praise you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, as the choir gets ready, I do want to say, I don't know if all of you saw it yesterday at all or on Facebook or whatever, we have some amazing young kids that know how to wrestle. And boys and girls, and to watch them wrestle and grapple, and I couldn't believe it. I know that I'm never going to fight with any of them, but that was fun. And the season's over now, right? No, it's still not done yet. Oh well, if you find time to get out and see them, go see them. So let's have the choir do their thing.
Thank you.
It is a lot of fun to be able to get together and sing and to enjoy that time of fellowship, but also to be able then to share that gift that God has given us with our voices. If you want to be a part of the choir, please come by. Come down. Do it as often as you can, but it is a very fun time, and thank you everybody who's part of it. So with that being said, let's go ahead and please stand, and let's turn to our Lord and confess our sins. Gracious God and Father, we bow before you as Lord and Savior of all. We confess to you that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We ask that you would wash us with your blood and make us clean. Though our skins are like scarlet, cleanse us and make us as white as snow. We ask that you would separate us from our sins as far as the east is from the west. We will praise you through all eternity for your goodness, grace, and mercy. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Let's also confess what we believe with the Apostles' Creed as it is printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You might be seated. The call to worship this morning is from the 119th Psalm, where we read in Jesus' name, I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your just and righteous decrees. Blessed are those whose ways is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies and seek him with their whole heart. You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. Let us pray. Oh Lord, graciously hear the prayers of your people, that we who justly suffer the consequence of our sin may be mercifully delivered by your goodness to the glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Father God, I come before you again, and I again thank you for this amazing day. Thank you for the time we can be in your house worshiping you. Thank you for loving us right where we are. Lord, I thank you for how you have been working with so many people's lives and how you have touched them in a very special way. Lord, I lift up Fleet O'Reilly's family to you and ask for you to continue to comfort them. As they remember her, and Lord, I thank you for the service we had this last week. Continue to be with Shirley Ochsner as she heals and help her to fight the pain that she has. For Miriam, Lord, you know what she went through this week, and so we're asking you to touch her collarbone and her all the things that happen. But we lift her up to you. For Wyatt, Lord, just continue to strengthen him and his family. For John and Roger and Mindy, continue to be with. Thank you, Lord, for the new baby that was given to Darius and Haley. Continue to be with those that are not feeling well. I think of the Hinks family this morning. Lord, be with them as they get stronger. Be with our medical personnel and staff, and our fire and police departments, our EMS, our military. Lord, be with our country. Lord, you know right now that there is a lot of division and dissension. And so, Lord, I'm asking that you would let us turn, like the last song we just sang, turn to Jesus. For our community and our students, Lord, we got to watch them wrestle yesterday and the basketball teams. And, Lord, I know that they're busy. But be with them and protect them. Our schools, be with our congregation. Be with our leadership of our congregation. Be with the church volunteers that do so much, but Lord, I know that they do it unto you. Lord, I know that this morning is a very special day that we can be in your house. And so, Lord, I thank you again for allowing us be here and have the freedom to do so. Lord, I love you and I thank you and I praise you. In your precious and holy name I pray, in Jesus' name, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The scripture readings this morning are printed in your bulletin, and the first one is from the Old Testament, from Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 5 through 10. It's the passage of scripture we're going to be looking at this morning. Jeremiah 17, 5 through 10, reading in Jesus' name. This is what the Lord says: cursed is the man who trusts in mankind and makes flesh, who trusts in mankind and makes flesh his strength, and whose heart turns away from the Lord. For he will be like a bush in the desert, and will not see when prosperity comes, but will live in stony wastes in the wilderness, a land of salt that is not inhabited. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, and whose trust is the Lord. For he will be like a tree planted by the water, and extends its roots by a stream, and does not fear when the heat comes, but its leaves will be green. And it will not be anxious in a year of drought, nor cease to yield fruit. The heart is more deceitful than any else, and is desperately sick. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I test the mind, to give to each person according to his ways, according to the results of his deeds. This is the word of the Lord. The New Testament lesson is from 1 Corinthians 15, verses 12 through 20. Again, reading in Jesus' name. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection from the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith also is in vain. Moreover, we are even found to be false witnesses of God, because of we testified against God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then even Christ has been raised, and if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If we have hoped in Christ only in this life, we are of all people most to be pitied. But the fact is, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the gospel lesson from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 6, verses 11 through 26. Luke 6, 11 through 26, reading in Jesus' name. But they themselves were filled with senseless rage and began discussing together what they might do to Jesus. Now, it was at this time that he went off to the mountain to pray, and he spent the whole night in prayer with God. And when day came, he called his disciples to him and chose 12 of them, whom he also named as apostles: Simon, whom he also named Peter, and his brother Andrew, and James, and John, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon, who is called the Zealot, Judas the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. And then Jesus came down with them and stood at a level place, and there was a large crowd of people, or a large crowd of disciples, and great multitudes of people from all of Judea and Jerusalem and the coastal region of Tyre and Sidon, who had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled by unclean spirits were being cured. And all the people were trying to touch him, because power was coming from him and healing them all. And he raised his eyes towards his disciples and began saying, "Blessed are you who are poor, for your kingdom of God, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when the people hate you and when they exalt, exclude you and insult you and scorn your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice on the day and jump for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. For their father used to treat the prophets the same way. But woe to you who are rich, for you are receiving your comfort in full. Woe to you who are well fed now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all the people speak well of you, for their father used to treat the false prophets the same way. This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated, and if the kids want to come forward for a children's message. Come to Jesus. Hi, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. All right, thank you. That's good. Hey, you know, this morning it's I'm glad you're here. It's so much fun when I get to come and see you and spend time with you. But you know, it's fun to see you and do that. But I guess it's because we all like to be joyful, right? So, what brings you joy? Anything? Jesus brings you joy. Done. Your family, okay. Well, think of something that you like to play with, maybe. Something that is fun to play with. I brought something today. You know what this is? Bubbles. Are bubbles fun? So when you do play with bubbles, what do you, is there a game that you play, or do you just like to chase the bubbles? Like, whoop, see, I'm not good at it, I don't think. Oh, whoa. And you know what? When we see the bubbles, don't you want to just reach out and touch it? Don't you want to reach out? Oh, what happens when you touch it?
It flies.
It vanishes. It's gone. It's no longer there. So what you're saying is this right here gives you a little joy. And you can see it and it's fun. And then you touch it, right? And then it's gone. That joy vanishes really fast because it's man-made. Man-made joy. Now, some of the things that make people joyful or happy, you know, I think of some of them like money maybe will make you happy, or food. I love food. Food makes me happy sometimes. Or entertainment. I like watching TV, and I like going to movies, and I like watching sports and stuff like that. Or even friends and family, they kind of make me happy. But, you know, when I talk about money or food or entertainment, you know, those things all can go away. Because eventually, when we leave this earth and go to be with Jesus, we won't have to take our money with us or the food or the entertainment that we have. And in the passage of Scripture that I just read, Jesus knew that people often looked for happiness and joy in the wrong places. He even said we might be happier if we were poor or hungry or crying or disliked by others. But why would Jesus say those things? Well, here's a few reasons. When we're poor, we can trust in God to supply everything that we need, right? When we're hungry, when we hunger for God and His righteousness, we realize that only He can satisfy our hunger. When we cry, we can trust in God to comfort us and to ease our pain. We all want to be happy, don't we? Don't we? And don't spend your time trying to catch a bubble, even though bubbles are fun, but it's not going to last forever. So let's talk to Jesus, okay? Dear Father, help us remember that we can find happiness by seeking things this world that we cannot find happiness by seeking things this world has to offer. True happiness only comes by following you, Jesus. We love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So I'll let you grab a snack, and we're going to go ahead and sing hymn number 184, but I also think I have enough. Don't open this until after you leave church, okay? You want some bubbles for later on today? There you go. All right. 184. Oop. Let's bow for word and talk to our Father. Father God, again, we come before you in your house, and we thank you for this time we can worship you. Thank you for your word, for we know your word is true and inerrant and inspired and fallible, and we know that you use it to teach us, to train us, but also to comfort us. And today, as we take a look at this passage of Scripture where Jeremiah is giving some very practical preaching, Lord, I'm just asking that you would bless the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts in your precious and holy name, Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as we take a look at this passage of Scripture in Jeremiah 17, verses 5 through 10, it really comes out to be very similar to what our world is today. To what when we sit and look at what Jeremiah was saying. He was warning, he was teaching, he was explaining some very, very truth of Scripture. And so, like I said, if you have your Bibles or the Bibles in your pew, or we've already read it once, but we're going to go through it in just a little bit more, Jeremiah 17, 5 through 10. And as we see here, this is an excellent doctrine that is being preached in these verses. And of general concern to all of us. And it does not appear to have a particular reference or a present state of Judah or Jerusalem, but Jeremiah's sermon, like I said, was not always prophetic, but it was very practical. And because we see here the hearts of the Jewish leaders had turned away from the Lord and turned away from his truth. And because of that, they made unwise decisions and plunged the nation into ruin. Like I said, very similar to our world today. The Jewish people had a record. They had a record of unbelief, and if unbelief that kept that the people of Israel out of the promised land. We see that in Numbers 13 and 14. And it was unbelief that caused them to worship idols and to invite the chastening of God during the time of the judges. During the time of this kingdom, it was unbelief that kept the leaders from repenting and turning to God for help, because they became entangled in costly political deals and involving Assyria and Egypt and Babylon. I guess my question is, will they ever learn? Well, if we look in the mirror today, we kind of see a lot of the same thing. No, this is not going to be a political sermon. It's not going to be. But we can look at some of the ties that go between the two. But if we look at the scripture, look at verses 5 through 8 of Jeremiah 17, we see two different pairs of personalities. So 5 through 8 says this: "Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in mankind and makes flesh his strength, and whose heart turns away from the Lord. For he will be like a bush in the desert, and will not see when prosperity comes, but will live in stony waste in the wilderness, in land of salt without inhabitants. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, and whose trust is the Lord. For he will be like a tree planted by the water that extends its roots into the stream and will not fear when the heat comes, but its leaves will be green, and it will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor cease to yield fruit." So we see these two types of people. One is like a stunted shrub in the desert, and the other, which is the godly or fruitful man, is like a deeply rooted tree planted by the riverbank. Two kinds of people are contrasted: those who trust in human beings for those, and those who trust in the Lord. The people of Judah were trusting in false gods and military alliances instead of God, and thus they were barren and fruitless. But as we take a look throughout Scripture, we have to take a look at a couple different passages. The first one is 2 Chronicles 32, 7 through 8. 1 Chronicles 32, 7 through 8, where we see, "Being strong and courageous, do not fear or be dismayed because of the king of Assyria, nor because of all the horde that is with him. For the one with us is great, and that one with him. With him is not only an army of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God to help us to fight our battles." And the people relied on the words of Hezekiah, the king of Judah. Here we see that Hezekiah, he could see with eyes of faith. The numbers of his opponents meant nothing as long as he was on the Lord's side. Victory is not by force nor by strength, but by my spirit, says the Lord of the heavenly army. Hezekiah could confidently encourage his men, his army, because he had no doubt about where he stood with God. Are you on the Lord's side? Are you standing with God? You may never face an army, but the battle you face every day can be won with God's strength. And that's one of the things that I'm seeing here. All throughout Scripture, we see that when you turn to the Lord, when you turn away from what you think is the strength and rely on Him and Him only, you will continue to get stronger. Isaiah chapter 30, verses 1 through 5. Another passage of Scripture where we see where Judah is warned against the Egyptian alliance. "Woe to the rebellious children, declares the Lord. Woe to who execute a plan, but not mine. And may an alliance, but not of my spirit, in order to add sin to sin. Who proceeds down to Egypt without consulting me, to take refuge in the safety of Pharaoh, and to seek shelter in the shadow of Egypt. Therefore, the safety of Pharaoh will be your shame, and the shelter in the shadow of Egypt your humiliation. For their princes are at Zoan, and their ambassadors arrive at Hans. Everyone will be ashamed because of a people who cannot profit them, you are not for help or profit, but for shame and also for reproach. Here we see the rebellious children of people of Judah who have rebelled against God. The negotiations for an alliance were underway, and Isaiah condemned and their twisted plan. The people of Judah sought advice from everything and anyone but God. When we are driven by fear, we tend to search everywhere for comfort and advice, to get relief, hoping to find an easy way out of our troubles. Instead, we need to consult God. Although He gives emergency help in times of crisis, He prefers to be guided throughout our life. By reading His Word and by speaking with Him and actively doing His will, we can maintain our bond with Him, who provides stability no matter what the crisis. You know, this is kind of in contrast with those who trust in the Lord flourish like trees planted along the riverbanks. In Psalm chapter 1, when I was putting this sermon together and praying about it, Psalm chapter 1 kept coming up. And I remember back in the day, well, many days ago, I had messed up. And my father, who I love and who you've met, one of his punishments was because he thought I was too old to spare the rod and spoil the child, but he thought I should go to my room, and instead I had to memorize scripture. And this is the first one that I remember coming out, because I'd have to come out and recite it to him and then go back in, because he's like, nope, it's not right yet. Go memorize it again. So listen to Psalm chapter 1, because, well, just listen. How blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the paths of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law he meditates day and night. He will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yield its fruit in its season, and its leaves do not wither. And in whatever he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but they are like chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous, for the Lord knows the ways of the righteous, but the ways of the wicked will perish. So we take a look at that passage of Scripture, Psalm chapter 1, where the writer here begins the psalm praising enthusiastically. And the joys of obeying God and refusing to listen to those who discredit or ridicule Him. Think about your friends or your associates, your acquaintances, who have a profound influence on each one of us, often in a very subtle way. If we intend on a friendship or relationship with those who mock with God, consider or think about the relationship with God as unimportant, we might sin by becoming indifferent to God's will. This attitude is the same as mocking. Do your friends build you up in your face, or do they tear it down? True friends should keep you drawn closer to God, not hinder your relationship with Him. Because God does not judge people on the basis of their race, their sex, their national origin. He judges them on the basis of their faith with Him. The all-knowing God, the omniscient God, will be blessed. Those are like healthy fruit bearing trees planted along the riverbanks in strong roots. And God promises to watch over them. God's wisdom guides their lives. But as we have continued to see this in different passages of Scripture, in contrast, those who don't trust and obey God have meaningless lives that blow away like dust. Only two paths of life lay before us: God's way of obedience or the way of rebellion and destruction. I'm telling you, be sure to choose God's path, because that path that you can choose right now is where you'll spend eternity. But as we get back to the passage of Scripture, because in times of trouble, those who trust in human beings will be impoverished and spiritually weak, so they will not have strength to draw on. But those who trust in the Lord, those who have the Lord on their side, will have abundant strength, not only for their own needs, but also the needs of others. Are you satisfied right now? Are you satisfied right where you're at right now? Are you in the desert, or are you like a well-planted tree to have strength in times of crisis? Because we do have our God, who is our God, is an the all-knowing, omniscient God. And as we look back at the original scripture from verses 9 and 10, listen to these words from Jeremiah 17, 9 and 10. The heart is more deceitful than all else and is desperately sick. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I test the mind, even to give to each man according to his ways, according to the results of his deeds. Remember where we started. The leaders of Judah were prone to trust in political allies and their own self, their own selfish, their own bodies, instead of depending on God. But then we see that Jeremiah then continues to show, as we see up on the screen now, a desert bush and a fruit tree by the water, which we also just saw in Psalm chapter 1. Unbelief turns life into parched wastelands. Faith makes it a fruitful orchard. Soon, as you read further in this scripture passage, soon the Babylonian army will overrun the kingdom of Judah, and the land of milk and honey would become a wasteland. As we think of the heart, the heart of every problem is the problem in the heart. And the human heart is deceitful and incurable. You know, this week, you know, having a Fleeta Riley's memorial service and listening to what her family said about her, she was a very well-planted tree. And then over the week, things come up. And busyness happens, and different things happen that you have no control over. And when that happens, the only way we're going to make it through is by turning to the Lord. Turn to Jesus. And as we heard that song sung today, you know, my father says I share way too much personal stuff, but deal with it. That's who I am. And there's been a couple things this week that have happened that I could not control, even though I wanted to. Right? Things that happened for a reason. And you can turn and get upset, or you can turn to God. Look to Jesus. Well, the last couple mornings, I've been having a really hard time because I've been trying to control. Trying to continue, as I was going over this sermon again, I'm going, this is straight to you today. This is straight to you. Because what it was, I had taken my eyes off of Jesus. I'll tell you that. I did. I looked to myself. I looked to others. They were not going to help me look and turn to Jesus. Trying to find, like I read before and was saying before, trying to find any comfort or joy in anything else that would help make these things go away. And as we're down here talking to the kids with the bubbles and watching the bubbles and how cool it is at first, but then you reach out and grab it and it goes away. Okay? The things that of this world are things that will eventually go away. And Jeremiah is talking to them about where are they standing with the Lord? Where are they right now? Are they a bush out in the desert, drowning in dust? Or are they a firmly planted tree that will never, ever be taken away? And then he talks about the motivation, the very end in verse 9 and 10. That's what he's talking about. He's talking about what are your motives? Why did you do this? Why are you keep doing this? He knew about the people of Judah right here. He knew their hearts. He knew that they kept running to something else and not turning to him. God knew their heart. And when we think of the heart and that it is deceitful and incurable, we might say, well, you know what, it's okay. I know my own heart. But you know what? We don't know our own heart. Only God does. The all-knowing God, where he searches our heart and our minds and knows exactly what we need when we need it. If we want to know what our own hearts are like, we must read the Word of God and let the Spirit then continue to teach us. God makes it very clear in his scripture right here. God makes it very clear why we sin. It's a matter of the heart. The heart is inclined towards sin from the times we were born. And it is easy to fall into the routine of forgetting and forsaking God. This is where we see and view our all-knowing God, who sent his son Jesus to save the lost, to pay the price for our rebellious and self-destructive and selfish heart. That's right, I said it. Rebellious, self-destructive, and selfish. As we look in Mark, because we have to think about he sent Jesus here. And when he sent Jesus here, he had a mission. He had something to do. He was here, like I said, to seek and to save the lost and to pay the price. Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2, verses 16 and 17, where we see this. When the scribes and Pharisees saw that he was eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they said to his disciples, "Why is he eating and drinking with tax collectors and sinners?" And hearing this, Jesus said to them, "It is not those who are healthy who need a physician, but those who are sick. I did not come to call the righteous, but to call sinners." In that piece right there, Jesus, God knows us. God knows us. He knows our heart. He knows our mind. He knows exactly what we go through. And we see here the self-righteous Pharisees were angry that Jesus would eat a meal with such sinners. But Jesus would gladly associate with the sinners because he loved them. Because he knew that they needed to hear what he had to say. Jesus spent time with whoever needed to hear or wanted to hear his message. The poor, the rich, the good, the bad. We also look in Mark chapter 7, verses 21 and 22. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed the evil through thoughts, fornications, thefts, murders, and adulteries, deeds of covering and wickedness, as well as deceit, sexuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these things, the evil actions begin with the single thought. It happens in the heart, allowing our mind to dwell on all those things that are trying to destroy us, focusing on evil. Instead, here Paul is advising the Philippians in chapter 4 to think about what's true and honorable, right, pure, lovely, and admirable. As I shared that little personal story about what I've been going through this week, I know that if I'm going through these things, that we all are. That we all are taking our eyes sometimes off of Jesus when a problem comes up. But then he gives us a promise in Romans chapter 8, verses 26 and 27. Last night, a good friend of mine who's sitting way in the back, he sent me this verse, and I appreciated it. But Romans chapter 8, 26, 27, 28. In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches the hearts know that the mind of the Spirit is because he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Verse 28 is this, and we know now that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. What does that verse mean to you? Those verses mean to you? It should mean, no matter what you're going through, God has you. Our all-knowing God, our omniscient God knows everything that we need when we need it. And he sends people like Jeremiah to go remind them. He sends people like John and Paul and Peter and the rest of the disciples to go out and spread the good news of Jesus Christ. He then continues to teach us right where we are, right where you are sitting right now. He's teaching you to keep your eyes on Jesus. Not to look to your own strength, not to look to your own abilities, because we all have them. But what he's saying, he goes, turn to me. Turn to me and I will give you rest. If you give your whole heart to me, take your eyes off of your sin, off of your problems, and turn to Jesus. Turn your eyes to me. I will take care of you because I know everything about you. I am all knowing. God knows everything and is always with us. This does not mean that because evil things will happen continue, but we still have God who will step in and take care of our every circumstance. God is not working to make us happy. I found this quote. God is not working to make us happy, but to fulfill his purpose. Tell you what, church, all those who love God are called or are called by him, that have received Jesus, these people have a new perspective, a new mindset. They trust in God, not in worldly treasures. Their security is in heaven, not on earth. Their faith in God does not waver in pain in persecution, because they know God is with them. So I guess what I'm saying today is what I'm trying to say today is that when we take a look at this passage of scripture, this passage that Jeremiah is teaching and preaching, and he's telling us exactly and making it so very crystal clear. Are you looking to yourself? And then by doing that, you will be that bush in the desert? Or are you looking to God who is going to continue to feed you and to make you strong as a tree planted next to a stream? But then he's also telling us and warning us that he knows everything and is continually working on our heart to bring us in that relationship with him. Do you have that relationship with him? Are you a firmly planted tree, or are you a bush out in the woods? Out in the desert. My hope is that you are a firmly planted tree and that Jesus is in your heart. Let us pray. Father God in heaven, Lord, I am sorry. I'm sorry for my sin. And Lord, Lord, as we are here today as a church family, Lord, I'm just asking that you would continue to use the words of Jeremiah and let it speak to our hearts today. Convict us if we are not in the right place. Let us turn to you, turn to Jesus, because you know our heart, you know our motives, you know everything about us. And Lord, as I do ask for forgiveness for my sins, I'm leaving this congregation to you and saying, Lord, this is your church. It's not my church, it's your church. And I know you're at work because I watch you. I see it. And I am sorry that I turn sometimes and look to myself. So, Lord, let us continue to remember that we need to turn to you and have you in our hearts and let you guide us in all that we do. I love you, Lord. I thank you. I praise you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Could you please stand with me and let's sing our final closing hymn number 171, Praise to the Lord the Almighty, 171. Please join me praying the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction from Romans chapter 15. Now may the God of hope fill you all with joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.